Okay, guys. Look at that. So we have our stuff. Pull this back.
The promise of snark puts a lot of pressure on us.
It does actually put a lot of pressure. That's okay. So do these high chairs. I had a little trouble getting up on these last panel. All right, so the format here is we're going to talk a little bit about the first half of it is talking about what we do for a living and a little bit issues that face us as critics and writing about television. And perfect timing, by the way. Perfect timing. Good. In the second half, like I said, will be a debate, and we'll throw out some topics, and you guys can contribute as well. So I wanted to start it off with, for you guys, I'm sure, for me, I know this is the question I get all the time. I never really have a good answer for it, but this is always the first question. It's how many hours of television do you really watch?
Daily, weekly, monthly?
Weekly.
So figure maybe 26 hours a day, give or take. So... it would be almost impossible to say, and the answer is more TV than there are hours in the day, really, because we're watching things on screeners, so those times we get 42 minutes in an hour, and that's a total life bonus. but really and truly, the answer is somewhere between 7 or 8 hours a day, or 9, and the weekends can be a good deal more sometimes.
Right. It really depends, honestly, on what's going on right then. How much do I actively watch? You know, a lot of stuff I'm working on other stuff and having like split screen and I'm just sort of vaguely paying attention to. I've watched so much Wayward Pines that way. But but like, you know, the stuff I actively watch is, you know, still quite a bit, like, I don't know, 2-3 hours of like active watching a day.
Yeah, 8 or 10 sounds about right. And there, active watching is a good distinction because there's a lot of shows that are sort of like in the second tier of watching, where I'll put on like a late night show and just pay attention when I need to, or a house show, or any other kind of talk show really, and just have it on kind of like the radio.
Yeah, no, I love the idea of active watching or not. So you're folding laundry and you're multitasking.
I think that's fine because that's how most people consume television. Like most people have TV on while they're dealing with their kids or cooking a meal or something. And so I don't feel particularly bad if I'm watching, you know, The Big Bang Theory while I'm doing my taxes.
Yeah, that's not even counting the time that I'm watching House Hunters and House Hunters International, which I can do so many other different things while I'm doing it. But, you know, that's probably another 4 or 5 hours a day. So
I love that you say that when we get a screener that has 42 minutes in it, that's a life bonus. The extra, yeah, I know, so the time. I bring it up because, John Solberg from FX told me last night these numbers have gone up, but I'm not sure if you guys had seen it. FX, they did some research in the summer, I think it was the summer, and they came up with, yeah, it was the winter, and they came up and they said, first of all, there's 1,715 shows on primetime right now. 1,715 shows, only in primetime, so that's 8 to 11. Of those, 352 of them are scripted. So that's a lot of television. And John Solberg from FX said last night that the number now for scripted is about 407. So it's just going up. So it really puts a lot of increased pressure on us to do what we do, and I think that in some ways creates real issues, and I know that we get feedback not only from people who are reading it, but people in the industry about, like, you know, what are the issues that face you when you have these increased viewing demands? Because at this point, you can't watch it all. You can't just sit there, no matter how many hours you have in the day, and get it all done. What are some of the changes that you guys have noticed when you're doing work based on too much stuff, just too much TV?
I pay a lot more attention to what people are talking about on Twitter or, you know, the internet, because being a TV critic to some degree is thinking what you know about NCIS and not watching NCIS every week, but holding out hope that NCIS is suddenly going to turn into the best show on TV and you're going to have to, like, go start watching it weekly. Like, for instance, there's a show called Steven Universe that I watched 3 episodes of and thought, this is not for me, and, like, tuned out. And, like now people are talking about how it's brilliant and whatever, and I'm going to have to go get caught up on it. But it's, like, keeping an eye on what other people are talking about, like, what dedicated TV viewers are talking about, and honestly, like, what my mom is talking about. Because not that she's, like, got cutting-edge TV tastes, but, like, what she's into is stuff that people are actually watching. And, like, if she's really into Blue Bloods this season, maybe I need to watch an episode of Blue Bloods. I didn't need to watch an episode of Blue Bloods, but I did, so.
And the thing you didn't even mention, Tim, is, okay, so all the shows that are in primetime, but then you have Netflix, and pretty much now almost on a weekly basis, Netflix is dropping 13 episodes of TV shows on us. And so that's not even the same as keeping up with anything on a weekly basis. It's the utter terror of waking up in the morning and discovering 13 hours of additional TV that I wasn't going to watch before. And I, in many cases, don't necessarily want to watch now. I mean, those additional 13 hours of House of Cards, not going to make me happy, but eventually I'm going to watch it. And that's now suddenly weekly. And then that becomes, that goes back to what Todd is saying, because we can only watch so much of that. But anyone who wants to watch those 13 hours of House of Cards, they can do it and they'll be ahead of us.
Right.
And so if someone wants to tell me season 3 of House of Cards was fantastic, I probably have to at least vaguely take that seriously.
They're lying to you.
I have to take their warning seriously that I should block them on Twitter. But, you know, otherwise, though, but it really, there just gets to be, it piles up at a rate that becomes absurd. Most shows pile up one per week, but Netflix has gotten to the point where like twice per month, things pile up 13 in a Friday.
Yeah, that's, go ahead. Go ahead, Tara.
Oh, I was just going to say, the advantage of being the editor of a site is that I can assign a lot of it out, because there's a lot of shows that I sample and I can tell immediately, this is for someone, it's not for me, so I don't need to continue to watch it. I don't feel the obligation to do it just to be like, as they say, part of the conversation. I mean, buzz is for sure a big part of how we determine what we cover, but I also have my, like, I hesitate to say passion shows. I call them garbage shows because they're garbage shows. But like, you know, Arranged on FYI may not be the biggest show on television, but I watched and covered every episode.
Wow.
So you have to make room for like your, what's in your heart, even if what's in your heart is garbage.
One thing that I switched jobs about a year ago, and like one thing I've gone to a more general interest audience, and one thing I've noticed is like in the interview process, my boss asked me, have you heard of this show, Friday Night Lights? And I was like,
that's,
yes,
adorable.
That is a very good show. He's like, it's a great show. And like, the general interest audience increasingly is just watching stuff on Netflix that could be from literally any era of television, and they think it's new. Like, if they're watching Leave It to Beaver now, it's new to them. Like, and how, like, I don't know how you chase that audience necessarily, but like, that means that I have to be a lot more on top of Netflix than I am like regular network stuff. And that's like a weird, brutal schedule where I'm going to be watching Sense8 in the line for Franklin Barbecue on Sunday morning. So,
I heard that you shouldn't waste your time. No, that's you know, Dan's nightmare of waking up to 13 hours sitting there at Netflix. It's a real issue because you mentioned about the audience getting ahead of us, which is, it's a weird position for us because we're supposed, I mean, not that we're entitled, but we're supposed to be ahead and we're supposed to be able to say
we're entitled.
It really kind of shifts the dynamic. It's like, really? You guys are now doing my job. That's awesome. Was it any good? Was Sense8 any good? I didn't watch it. So we do fall behind based on this overload and how it changes. One of the things that I notice is that, which is sort of getting to the next question, is how, because all of us probably have a technique that we use when we're watching it. And I know that my rule for when a network sends out one show, just the pilot, is that I absolutely say in there, I can't, that this is not a review, that this is just, anything can happen, because A, it's the pilot, which is really just a sales tool. The grandmother won't be in it next week, right? Maybe the lead actor won't be in it next week. I mean, there's a lot of that. Sometimes they fix it before we get it, but sometimes they don't. And sometimes they, as we've known for some of the shows, it just lasts, they change the premise at the end of the first season. So if it's only one, my feeling is I can't give an honest review. I just say, look, this is all they sent. I can't really tell you if it's good or bad, because there's been too many times where I've said, flash forward, great pilot, this is going to be awesome, and then it's not awesome. So how many, especially in this world where we're sometimes getting one episode, sometimes you're getting four or five from a cable channel, and if there's a mid-season show like Wayward Pines, which Dan's doing the next panel, you do get those six episodes in advance, and then there's things where you wake up in the morning, there's 13. So how many are you watching before you have to make a decision whether you like it or not?
I watched all of Aquarius, which was not a great decision, but I feel like a pilot is not enough anymore, but also I feel like I can, in a review, say enough stuff that's like, this is just a review of the pilot, that people are going to take that with a grain of salt. I feel like the people who read about TV online are pretty savvy about how that all works increasingly. Much more savvy. I'm writing about movies now, and they're much more savvy than movie fans about like how the film world works. So I generally feel like for dramas, serialized dramas, I'll give it like 4. Procedural dramas, I'll give it like 2. But like a comedy, I'll give it 6 or 7. Comedy's harder. It takes time.
But will you do that before the review or like just before you quit on it?
Both. No. Like we had this thing when I worked at the AV Club that we were going to do. We did Inconsistently, where we checked in with every new show 7 episodes in. And like, I think that that is a good rubric, and I wish more networks sent out 6 or 7 episodes. Well, I appreciate that's impossible.
Yeah, I mean, my policy has always been, had always been, got to get the tense right, that I would watch whatever I was sent of just about anything, and that included a lot of really awful things that I watched an awful lot of, and in some cases where I requested specifically as many as they had available of things. Like, I watched 7 episodes of Mixology because that's how many they were willing to send me.
Oh my God, this is a horror show. This really is a horror show.
Is this group therapy?
Look, if we want to start getting into the things that I watch entirely out of self-flagellation, we can do that.
Please.
But I don't do that anymore because there just is not time. And so 13 episodes of Aquarius, that just was not going to happen.
Your colleague, Alan Sepinwall, tried to get me to stop, but I was not stopping. I was doing that.
He tries to get me to stop constantly, and he understands that mostly I don't because I'm compulsive, but I can't do it anymore. And so sometimes, like, if it's a procedural, I will say to a network publicist, okay, I kind of hated these next 3. Does it get better? If so, tell me where.
Do they?
Oh, no, they'll say this is a better episode. Yeah, totally. Huh. And with a comedy where if it's not like serialized, you can say, okay, I know it sometimes takes a show like Younger a few episodes to get better. When should I check back in? And they'll sometimes tell you. Alternatively, sometimes something like, say, hypothetically, the CW's The Messengers, you'll beg the publicist, you'll say, look, I don't know what this show is. It caused me physical pain to watch the pilot, and yet I'm still willing to watch additional episodes if you'll give me more episodes. And then you won't even get a response for it. So, you know.
Well, when they don't give you more episodes, that's usually a sign. Like, no, that's all we've shot. Yeah, that's a lie. We know how the industry works.
You guys are much more conscientious than I am. I'll bail on a show in the middle of a show. Like, I'll quit a pilot if I can tell it's not. It's triage. Like, life is short. There's 7 billion hours of TV a week, as you said. Like, if something isn't grabbing me in 20 minutes, like, I don't have time. If someone tells me in 8 weeks that it got better, I'll circle back to it because now I have that option. But yeah, if it's pushing me away, I'm gonna let it push me.
That's interesting because from that perspective, I think that's doable from your job perspective. But from us, I think that I definitely have noted in reviews where I've been repulsed within 20 minutes and then I've stopped watching. But the review has been based around stop watching at 20 minutes because it was just heinous.
I mean, we have a feature on our site that's called Show Shot Clock, where that's the premise of it, where it's like, at what minute did you stop watching and why? And sometimes it's the opposite, like, what minute did it grab you enough that you had to keep watching? But no,
well, that's the thing. I think that's one of the issues of our times right now, because you want to keep watching, and I, you know, if something doesn't repel me, I'll watch it, and then I may not like it. I mean, I could only get through 2 of Aquarius. I mean, that was it. I mean, just Manson was not Manson. And it was just, and my review was like, you can't do the 60s. The 60s have been done so many times. It's just a gigantic cliche, even if you're David Duchovny. So I just couldn't do it. But other ones were, you know, I've bailed out at 20 minutes because it's just, it's an issue about time management. And I think that's, I don't know if you guys agree, but I think in the general audience, they look to reviewers and critics as, how save some time for me. You know, you just said there's 407 shows out there that are scripted. Tell me 5 to watch. I mean, that ends up being the thing. So you, in some ways, we end up being, you know, it's a doing a consumer, it's a PSA, basically. Like, don't watch this, save this hour. Because for people, time is the most valuable commodity these days. And if you say, don't watch, you know, if Todd watched all 13 of Aquarius, you know, someone, he took the bullet for you, right? I mean, that's... But right? But then there's times, and I'll go to Wayward Pines, where if the network is not on top of telling you what's happening, like Dan has asked them before, like, when does it get good? Or like, is there gonna be a shift here? I would say, and I'll just throw this out there for you guys, I was not totally sold on Wayward Pines the first two episodes. I didn't know if I liked it. And then when it started to shift, I was like, okay, that's kind of interesting. And then deeper into it, I kept watching, and it shifted again. And then there's a huge shift that Dan's going to will either hint at, but it's a humongous tone shift. And I was like, you guys didn't tell me that this was a whole new show in episode 5, I think.
Which is showing at 12:30 over, no, at 2:30 rather, over at the Alamo or something. Not 12:30, I have to run right now, sorry.
I'm just going
to
start showing the fifth episode of Wayward Pines right now because I'm not prepared.
But no, I mean, that's an example where they did send us out a lot of episodes in advance specifically because of that. And, you know, it was nice of them to send us episodes that were that important, but also, yeah, you know, sometimes they do us the service of making sure that we have the episodes we need to see, and sometimes they're just trying to drown us and stuff in the hopes that we'll drown.
You can tell when a network knows it has something, too. Like, the difference between how AMC treated season one of Halt and Catch Fire and season two of Halt and Catch Fire was night and day. Like, it was obvious they knew season one was kind of bad and that season two was pretty good. Like, that was very different. So, like, I mean, sometimes they're wrong. FX sent out 9 episodes of The Comedians for some reason. Like, but usually they have a pretty good sense of when they're going to have something we like.
Yeah, FX still doesn't think that they still think that was a good idea, and that we messed up, and it was a really great show.
And Tyrant is a classic, from what I understand.
Yeah,
but it's not.
By the way, I heard from that last night about that. So regarding The Comedians and FX, but one of the things that I'm wondering about the rest of you, because I don't do reality shows. I mean, if there's 1,715 of them, we don't have time. So we farm that out. We have freelancers do it, and my policy has always been, I'll do anything that's scripted, and that clearly has changed now because there's just too much. So how many of you do reality shows as well? And then talk a little bit about, like, if there is such a magical unicorn, a good work-life balance.
Oh, yeah, I watch reality shows and I write about them. But in specific categories, like, I'm not really that into competition shows usually. And I don't like the Real Housewives show at all. So there's a lot of, like, farming out. I mean, there's definitely siloing in formats. That said, I did watch Preach, which is premiering tonight on Lifetime, which is like the Real Housewives of charismatic female preachers. This is a real show. And so if you can imagine, like, a Real Housewives fight, except they're fighting over the sweaty towel that one gave to another one because it was full of divine powers, and the other one took it to a Mercedes dealership because she thought it meant they would give her a car. I swear to God, this happened. And it's on tonight on Lifetime. So sometimes if you don't watch those screeners, you miss crazy gems like that.
I'm totally watching that tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no question.
And I watch certain reality shows. I watch, you know, I do Survivor all the time. I do Amazing Race all the time. I do American Idol, which thankfully Fox is letting me out of my commitment to next year. And once I start on something, it's really hard for me to quit. So I watched 3 seasons of X Factor, for example, because Fox kept renewing it because they hated me. If you can come up with a better reason, tell me. But I still keep some limits because once you start digging into reality as well, there's just so much out there. And then even still, I feel guilty when I miss out on a couple repulsive things. Like, having read about Briefcase, I feel like I probably would have had angry things to say about it. And I regret now that I missed out on that opportunity, which will clearly never come again.
I don't watch a lot of reality, but, like, I feel like The Jinx was the most talked about show of the year, and, like, documentaries, I mean, reality is basically a very, very specific subset of documentary. So, like, I watched The Chair last year. I thought that was pretty brilliant.
Yeah, The Chair was good.
I enjoy Shark Tank most weeks. You know, it's good comfort food TV. But yeah, like, there's a lot of reality and a lot of it's junky, but I feel like sometimes there's so much of it that we do people a disservice in some ways. Like, one of our big, like, things people were looking for on our site when the Josh Duggar scandal happened was, like, who the hell are these people? But they've had, like, a TV show for 10 seasons that pretty much few critics in America have ever written about because it's just off in the hinterlands somewhere. And I think, like, to some degree, the huge wave of TV prevents us from writing about some of these fairly important shows.
That's a great point. I mean, because there is so much of it. And not even joking around, I would actually watch that show that you Preach.
Yeah, Preach.
I would kind of want to see that.
It's tonight at 9 Central on Lifetime.
Just one time. I would maybe watch that. But I think Todd brings up a good point too for us in our jobs is that there's you can't cover everything. And so what happens when you're dismissive of either a genre or a network or a channel and you don't like any of their stuff like TLC? Do you just not watch it? And at what point is, like you said, there's a disservice? I mean, is that something you really believe as far as how do we do our jobs when it's impossible to watch everything? I mean,
well, and the other question is how can you be critical about a show like 19 Kids and Counting where yeah. it's sort of like, it is what it is. Like you are either into it or you're not.
I think some of the most interesting writing we published when I was at AV Club was about Here Comes Honey Boo Boo, which was like this huge phenomenon, but like people just sort of reflexively wrote it off, and I can understand that and understand why that happened. But like, it was saying some interesting things about like, it wasn't saying them, but it was deeply implied if you dug around and tried. But it was like saying, but there were things about the American class system in there that scripted television just doesn't deal with at all.
Yeah, and I think that in that genre, and I know that we all have sites where it is farmed out to other people to do it, and it's not the main critic, it's not the main reviewer who's doing it. Or if you have, you know, two people like HitFix, who very, you know, both of them are known names, someone else who's not a known name is doing something like, you know, The Man with No Penis.
We didn't cover that one.
Well, it's not on yet, but you'll watch it. I mean, that's coming up. I mean, that is a real show, by the way. Sorry, it's coming up, The Man with No Penis.
What network?
A Discovery.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll check that out.
I tend not to cover shows that are about specific gradations of people's genitals. So neither The Man Without the Penis nor The Man with the Abnormally Large Scrotum.
Yes.
It was 132 pounds. Get it right.
Yeah.
I believe 132 pounds goes under the heading of abnormally large.
It's a subgenre.
I mean, I guess it depends on your experience.
But one of the things that's interesting...
Wow.
I just want to know.
Yeah, that's very disturbing.
One of the things that's interesting, though, is because everyone is getting into this marketplace, it makes it harder and harder for us to know when we're supposed to respect the new people. So something like WGN, well, for years, WGN was, you know, it was Cubs games. That was what it was. Yeah. And then they did Salem, and Salem is, you know, it's awful, but it's kind of awful in a fun way and whatever. And then Manhattan is actually a fairly smart, fairly textured period piece, and you had to realize, okay, this is the point at which I'm supposed to pay attention. And if you look at a lot of reviews of Unreal, which premiered this week on Lifetime, which is very good, a lot of people were saying, okay, we know you don't watch Lifetime except for Prey, starting
Preach.
Tonight. Preach, starting tonight at 9 on Lifetime. We know you don't watch it, but this is a show that's on Lifetime that actually is worth your attention. And so it's hard to know when exactly, you know, a little network that does badly butchered crop and, you know, pan and scan movies is going to make a show about 60s ad men, and it's going to turn out that it's going to change the network. You have to either, you know, pay attention at the right time or not.
Yeah, and I think that is an issue that we all face as we're talking about sort of how the sausage gets made on this side, is that there has to be a tipping point when you start to cover a network like WGN. I think Dan pointed out those two shows were the ones where not only were they good, I mean, Salem was its own thing, right? I mean, I reviewed that, but Manhattan is really good. And so how do you get people to watch Manhattan? First you say, oh, and by the way, I don't know about you, anybody here, because this is a more sophisticated bunch because they came today. But the general population, Gen Pop, they a lot of times don't know what they're paying for. I can't tell you, you guys probably run into this, so I'm like, they say, do I get that? I'm like, well, I actually don't live with you, so I don't know what you're watching or what you're paying for or who your cable company is, you know? And so in the reviews, oftentimes we have to say, hey, there's a channel called WGN. You may have never watched it. You actually may be paying for it. Go find it. And that's part of kind of what's coming to us as criticism now.
Again, writing for the more general interest audience, like I ran into that all the time with Fortitude, which I was on Pivot and was fantastic. And I kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And like people just were like, do I have Pivot? And like, I don't know, but it's and especially now as people are more and more catching up on Netflix, like they wait for something to become good. And then, you know, three seasons in, they'll catch up on Netflix. Like that's another thing that is sort of changing the dynamic of our relationship to readers, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just curious, raise your hand. How many people watch Fortitude? See, not many. And this is the high end here.
And at least four of those people are active television critics. So,
and how many of you watch Manhattan? Hands up. Yeah. So what we're getting from that kind of feedback from WGN is like, how the hell do we compete? You know, how do? And they can't come to us as adversaries. That's not really our role. So how do you compete in that universe? It's very difficult. And one of the I don't know what you guys hear. One of the things that I certainly hear is, you know, it's almost like, how can you help us? Like, you know, I'm like, can you please write about this? Whether it's a publicist or someone else, like, can you please write about this show? And it's getting harder and harder to peek above the water and know that a show exists. What do you guys think is going to be at the point when all of these channels stop getting into the scripted game and just go away?
Never. I think we're close. I really feel like within the next 5 years we're going to see sort of a bubble burst in this market, and it's going to go back to everybody airing really cheap reality or sitcom reruns.
Well, because it is very expensive to do scripted programming. To do a half-hour sitcom is, you know, $3 million, $2 to $3 million, depending who makes it, and upwards of 4 to whatever. I mean, I don't even want to know what Wayward Pines made. Does that like $8 million an episode, probably?
I think probably for pilots, certainly it's close to that.
Yeah. But at least with a sitcom, like if it hits, it can recoup its investment because it can go on in syndication forever, potentially. Right. But a syndicated like scripted show, I feel like that's way harder because if you're catching up on it when it's rerunning on whatever, like Hallmark tried for 3 weeks to run The Good Wife before I guess they got enough complaints about its racy material that they pulled it. But like anything, that really happened. But I can't imagine how any show like that like really can hit. Like it's not like, you know, with SVU you can air any 7 episodes in any order on USA. And I will watch them. But for other shows, it's much harder. Like, what's Manhattan going to do? Right. All they can do is keep having marathons and hope that people find out about them. Mm-hmm.
And a big part of the problem is they're chasing out the people in this room, which is a vanishingly small audience. Like, Disney Channel's going to be fine throwing talented 12-year-old actors on the air for the next, you know, 50 years. Like, but not everybody can do expensive scripted drama because the audience for that is very small. Like, Mad Men was never a hit.
Never, yeah.
But even the cases like that, whether Mad Men was a hit or not, and you know it wasn't, what it got AMC in terms of the brand was worth whatever they put into it, and so because of that, that's why they were able to have Walking Dead, and Walking Dead is a gigantic cash cow. And so if you're WGN, if your goal is we don't just want to be thought of as the Cubs game network, we want to be a place for serious drama, whatever, well, it doesn't matter so much if Salem and Manhattan are hits. It matters if the fifth thing down the road is Walking Dead, then you can recoup on the other stuff. So it's all relative what is or isn't a success or why anyone is or isn't doing what they're doing with these.
Well, one of the things too that I find interesting about this part is that if we move it away from, oh, poor WGN, no one really cares, right? I mean, it's an entity, it's a business. If you say, oh, it's really hard for Fox to launch a comedy, or in this case, NBC, no one really cares when it's just, right, NBC, right? I can't do it. Let's just give Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt to Netflix. You guys do it. But if you take it away from the corporate entity and you talk to people who are creatives and their showrunners, it's a whole different ballgame to hear their stories, which is really interesting. They're like, the first thing I tell them is I have no idea why you're in this game, because this is the hardest time in the history of television to be launching a show, to be writing a show. We're certainly in the continued renaissance that we all write about and talk about. We're still in the middle of that, but why you would get in at the risk and the uphill battle you face, it becomes very personal. And so when you hear their stories about how hard it is to do what we're talking about here, it's a little more, it's not just like the ratings didn't work and it's gone. Somebody came up with Fortitude, and it's kind of a great series. It's like a really interesting stretch. The actors and the writers who created Manhattan, that's a really, really interesting hour of television. And how are they going to get it known? I mean, I'm sure it's similar to a novelist, right? I mean, those guys are not going to be crying for TV shows that don't get audiences. But that's kind of what we're facing. I think that's a real interesting part of the industry right now. But I did want to move on to probably one of the hot button issues that we face. Is there a general theory that you guys have about spoilers?
Oh, once it airs, then...
What? Once it airs, like live?
Yeah, I mean, I like the number of people that were complaining about like like West Coast people on Twitter that were like, please don't live tweet the Mad Men finale, which first of all, get DirecTV and watch it live. Yeah. But second of all, like, get off Twitter. Like, I'm not in charge of your spoiler issues. Be an adult and stay off Twitter if you're concerned about it.
I try to be polite about spoilers, but I think that people who hate spoilers are just the worst. So like,
I'm really conscientious, like to a fault, about using hashtags so that people can mute it, and but drives me crazy that everybody else isn't, frankly, because I am crazy. But that's the only concession that I'll make.
A formative moment for me in my career was I was working as a copy editor at a newspaper the night Michael shot Ana Lucia and Libby on Lost. And it came in over the newswire and was like breaking, these characters died on Lost. And I was like, I didn't want to know that. And then I watched the episode and liked it much better knowing that was coming. Because like, if I had just, a lot of people who just watched it not knowing that were like only talking about the twist. And like knowing the twist let me see how it was set up. So, but I always read the last page of books as a kid, so.
And I try not to spoil things on Twitter. I try not to spoil things in, you know, headlines or in pictures or whatever, in articles that we post. But on the other hand, there have to be limits. And I don't necessarily think that the limit is when something airs on the East Coast, it's a free-for-all and everyone should go nuts. But, you know.
Thank you, as a fellow West Coast person.
Well, look, I didn't
say
go nuts.
It'd be a total gang throwdown right after this.
I live in Hawaii, so I feel like I have more stake in this than anyone.
Oh,
and I have
I
a
live
sling
in
box.
Hawaii.
I have a sling box in Syracuse, so I can watch Networks TV live. Because I'm crazy, but that also means, like, when people in LA were like, don't tell me what happened on the slap, which was, first of all, it's the slap. Second of all, like, figure your stuff out. That's not my job.
But that's the thing, and Todd was talking about the people who catch up with things only on Netflix. You know, I'm only going to be watching Breaking Bad, the last season on Netflix. So then for those people, spoilers on the Breaking Bad finale, that becomes like a 3 or 4 month waiting period.
Yeah, that's not my problem.
And that's just ridiculous. That's just too far. If you
prioritize your life.
I spoiled the Breaking Bad finale a year after it happened and got so much. And I specifically said, I'm going to spoil the Breaking Bad finale in the next sentence. I still got like 500, whatever.
And people are babies. No one here but other people.
And I feel like I do feel bad though when I spoil, you know, even something that's 3 years old. You know, if I spoil Citizen Kane for you, no, I'm not really sorry about that. But if I spoil that someone got shot last season at some point on The Good Wife and you hadn't gotten to it yet because you're much more busy and have more of a life than I do, well, you know, I mean, good for you on all of those things. But so I feel a little guilty in my heart, but still, screw you. Watch TV if you care.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, I think that the line is really shifting, and there's no clear way to sort of, there is no rule book or handbook. The line is definitely shifting. I do believe, Tara, that, you know, and I've said that to other people, I'm like, get off Twitter. West Coast,
get off Twitter,
right? Like, get off.
Not hard.
It's gonna, you know, you're gonna screw it up.
It's not like you're waiting for a text, it's Twitter. You're just like dicking around on Twitter.
But go ahead.
I am all for Tara's theory. When like Mad Max happens, I'm living in Tara's Thunderdome. Like that's where I'm
going. Thank you.
So yeah. I think it's great.
Yeah.
Thumbs up.
But then there is the element, because like Dan says, you don't want to spoil it because we're not as callous and hard ass as maybe it appears in print, right? Kind of.
Yeah, it's not. I'm making it sound like I go out of my way to ruin things for people. I don't, but I'm like, I'm not going to not live my life because you're concerned about your own schedule.
But it does sort of circle back to the whole thing where if we're talking about how much television's out there and this overwhelming amount of content, and if people are sort of trying to absorb it, they're going to get behind. And so when you say 7 days, you know, is it 3 days? Is it 7 days before you can say something huge happened? I mean, like if. And that's an issue. The one thing that drives me crazy is I still get like comments and emails and whatever. I don't. You know, we'll get to that in a second. But I still get comments and emails when I say, "Oh yeah, Stringer Bell died on The Wire," and people are like, "Wah!" And that's 100 years ago.
I was like, 2005, right? Like it was a long time.
Before that, I think. I mean, it's crazy, you know. Or you talk about The Sopranos, what everybody knows about the ending now. We don't go there. We are not going to that ending, whether Tony's alive or not.
What happened?
But there are older shows that people are, like Todd said, that people are discovering. Like I was talking about Friday Night Lights. That is insane to me that someone is watching Friday Night Lights now, but that's the world we live in. And so those are old spoilers. So that line doesn't that shifting line doesn't bother me.
I feel like within 24 hours of air, if somebody yells at me about spoilers, I'll feel a little bad. But, like, you know, after that.
I mean, on our site, the policy is we won't spoil major plot things in images on the homepage or in homepage copy. Yeah. And if you go deeper than that, you're on your own.
Yeah, at THR, one of the things I have is, like, I am not in Los Angeles. You couldn't pay me to live in Los Angeles, but I am also not at that desk. So that picture that they put up that spoiled it for you, that was not me. Yeah. So I get the kickback on Twitter. Comments. Who reads the comments?
I don't have comments, and it's wonderful.
Yay!
I read comments and often respond to them.
Depends. Sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. Sometimes I'll read to a point and then stop.
So I would be interesting when we get to have the audience ask questions whether they think that's a valuable service anymore. Because, I mean, when you get a group like this, yeah, I want to hear what they have to say. Generally, you can find those people on Twitter engaging in a conversation and not being trolls. And, you know, there's certain spots for that. I never, ever, ever read a comment. Never.
We open up our comments once a week to talk specifically about that week's episode of Mad Men or Game of Thrones, and it's a very heavily curated audience, and we have somebody watching and deleting stupid shit, and it's great. It's a wonderful experience. But you can't pay someone to do that on every article, which is why so many comment sections are so bad. It's like, you know, nobody's fault. It's just that humanity is an evil cesspool.
That's very concise.
That is true.
About people. That's very good. I did want to move on a little bit, because we did talk about when people give up on shows, like what minute do you give up on a show? How is it, is there a part when you give up on something that is at one point either A, the critical consensus, the show you should be watching, there is, a little pressure amongst peers to, like, I can't believe we're still watching that or not watching that, but when do you give up on a show that at some point was really great, say like Weeds?
I certainly didn't give up on Weeds, and Weeds was really good in the end, Tim.
I gave up on it. Yeah.
No,
they left a grass stick, they should have just burned the whole set down.
Honestly, it takes a lot to get me to give up on a show. You know, How I Met Your Mother was good for 3 or 4 years. It was awful for 4 or 5 years. And I watched every second of it. And complained about nearly every second of it. And keep in mind, that's part of what fuels me, is the ability to complain about things. But what it takes to get me to quit on something, honestly, is like what Kurt Sutter did on Sons of Anarchy, where suddenly FX stopped telling him to come in at a certain time. And that was what did it for me when episodes of Sons of Anarchy started running 75, 86 minutes, whatever. You got the feeling he wasn't telling FX, FX wasn't telling cable networks, so 5 minutes at the end would get cut off because no one had a clue what time it was. At that point, it was no longer worth it for me to watch an additional 5 minutes, to go online to seek out the 5 minutes I missed of a show I wasn't liking anyway. And so that was what got me to quit on that show. And that's what it takes to get me to quit on something.
Wow, that's, yeah.
I also don't give up on shows easily, but I will shift them to, I will catch up with this later. Like, yeah. Especially since I've stopped doing weekly reviews for the most part. Like, Good Wife hit that point for me this season where I was like, this show is not working for me anymore, but I will catch up at some point. And my wife was writing reviews of it, so I saw the occasional episode enough to know that I was, you know, not engaged with it anymore.
Yeah, usually for me, it's like if I care about less than 50% of the characters, it's less it, like something happens that I get outraged by more so than like, meh. Like, I mean, the first show that I remember quitting in the middle of an episode was the season 2 premiere of The OC. And people were like, was it when she threw the chair in the pool? And I was like, I don't even think I got to that point. Like, I just didn't care about any of the characters anymore. It didn't grab me.
I've definitely become more ruthless. I think I give up earlier than you guys do. But I feel like it's, you have to almost take the perspective of the, you know, person out there, the viewer, the general population viewer who's saying, you know what, I don't have time for this anymore. Yeah. So I give up rather than hang on.
The exception is if a long-running show is like, and now we're going to wrap it up, because I was about to quit Lost, and then they were like, but we have an end date now, so then I stayed, because I had to see.
I think looking at the ratings, though, I think the general population is more likely to stick with a show.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, I don't know very many people who still like NCIS LA, but like it still does pretty well. Well, not as much as it used to, but yeah.
Yeah, and I one of the things that I definitely will put it in the I'll watch it later pile. That's I think that's a new age stuff for us, and that can get you in a little bit of trouble. But if it doesn't catch me in the first couple of episodes, I'll say, okay, I'll watch it. Or especially if there's word on Twitter that it got better, you know,
yeah.
The show got better. I was like, really? Is that true? Well, then let's watch that later. So what about, this actually came up last night at the opening night party amongst people of certain networks I won't mention. They were a little disturbed that certain outlets, I won't name who, we're one of them, were not reviewing returning series that were now, one of them's going to be in their third and the other's in their fourth season. So what's your take, because if going back
again
to this avalanche of shows, I mean, I did Orange is the New Black season 3 because my boss said that everybody's going to want to know about that. And I loved it, but I don't specifically say, yeah, I'm coming back for, Tyrant season 2. Right? So, I mean, when do you not review a returning series?
When we just don't care, when it feels like it's kind of status quo, I guess. I think if there's a clear difference, if something starts off second season fantastically, it has value to let people know. Also, I think there's always still the fact that many of us do still review things largely because, we feel like we steer people or help people. And so a review of Hannibal season 3, Hannibal still needs people to talk about Hannibal season 3. So there's value in saying, okay, you're still not watching the show, but you still should be watching the show. And I'm just going to keep telling you to watch the show until someone takes the decision out of my hands.
I increasingly only review, and honestly, this is partially staff because I have a staff of 3, and that's been a huge shift for me. But I increasingly only review returning shows or new shows if they're fantastic. I feel like that is the most value I can give to somebody is saying, or they've dramatically improved. I wrote about Halt and Catch Fire season 2 because it was so much better. But I wrote about The Americans season 3 because people need to watch The Americans, and that was. But I'm not going to write about, this show is just what, I didn't even write about Louis, which I really love Louis, but I didn't need to say the same thing I've said about Louis, 500 times.
Right. So there was an element, sorry, I'll come right back to you, but there was an element of advocacy, you're saying. So for The Americans, we all feel that there's a certain advocacy role. And then Todd, you said, if it's fantastic, I'm going to not want to speak for people, but I'm lumping Mad Men in there. You have to, because year after year.
I guess the thing would be if a show came back and was just dramatically terrible. If the Mad Men season 7B premiere had been just Don Draper vacuuming for 42 minutes. I probably would have said to myself, brilliant. But I'd like to think I would have indicated to the audience. Actually, I wouldn't have been able to, because Matt Weiner would have sent out a memo that said, do not tell the audience that Don Draper vacuums for 42 minutes.
Or how long he vacuums. Good, Tara.
It's different for us because we don't really do straight reviews. We do blog posts about them. So if people are still interested in the show, we'll do weekly coverage of it. It's just more a matter of if I will do it or if I assign it out.
So do you think that's a social, a reading of a social thing, or is it just anecdotal that you're keeping up with something that's interesting?
On our site, you mean? Oh, well, we're directed by how many people are commenting on it after the episode airs. So if there's a critical mass of people that are talking about it on the boards, we'll stick with it. But otherwise, if no one cares and we don't care, then we will.
Well, what about
care.
If this woman down here puts 500 comments over the same show? Is she fueling it, or are you looking at different?
I mean, I don't do an audit of how many people are posting on the thread. So if you want us to cover something that we're not, I guess you could. You could spam our forum threads, but that doesn't really happen.
And the way people read the internet has shifted so much. It's shifted to coming in from Facebook and coming in from Google, and that audience is much more prone to read something after it airs. So I feel like the time for me to say Halt and Catch Fire season 2 was really good, probably is 6 months from now, which is ridiculous,
right.
But is increasingly the way that the audience is moving.
Yeah, I think that's actually another aspect of how things are shifting, that you know, the first wave, the early adopters and the early viewers, and then, like you said, there are people who say, I'm going to wait till that season ends. By the way, that drives people in the business insane. They're like, you can't wait till it ends. We'll be dead by then, so you have to watch our show. I wanted to get to one more question, because this is broken into two halves, but I want to get in one more question, and then I want to have people ask questions in the audience about this part, and then we'll get to the debate part. And this last question is, hopefully we'll put some thought into these answers. Are any of you afraid to be an outlier? when the review comes out? And this is a question that people have asked me before. So I thought I'd put in, are you worried? Are you ever like watch something and think, boy, I may be the only person who likes this?
There are times that things will simply not hit you in the way that you suspect that artistically they might hit other people. And so I don't know that I'm afraid, but sometimes I am cognizant of the idea that I am watching something that is going to hit other people in a completely different way. And there's at least the possibility that my reading was impacted by the Hot Pocket I just ate and the 15 hours of something else that I watched beforehand and who knows what, and that someone else with a clearer head might like something more. And so sometimes I do take the possibility into account that I could be not necessarily wrong, because I'm not.
Clearly not.
But that I could just be having my own opinion. And so something like American Crime, enough people said it was important and powerful and awesome that I acknowledge that for some people it probably absolutely is, and that for me it simply wasn't. And so with a show like that, I can accept being an outlier. If I'm not like passionately angry about it, I can just be passionately ambiguous or ambivalent and let other people deal with it.
I feel like the more episodes I have to watch, the more likely I am to like it, regardless of its quality in some cases. And I think that the binge watch...
Are we talking about Aquarius again?
No. I've gotten better at filtering out the part of me that gets Stockholm Syndrome when I'm watching 13 episodes of Aquarius. But like, it's definitely a thing where... if you watch a bunch of stuff in a row, and I feel like this is a problem of the Netflix format in general, if you watch a bunch of stuff in a row and you start to not see some of the critical faults in it. So I want to say that I don't like being an outlier, but I'm also the only positive review on Metacritic for Mind Games. So maybe I do sometimes. I don't know.
Note to self, go read that review.
I don't care. The thing about TV writing on the internet is twofold. One is that you're probably not the one and only person that someone's going to read about TV. If someone's really interested in TV, they're reading a whole range of critics.
Right.
And so if anyone's going to be really that upset, like the other seven people I read thought it was great and you're the only dummy that didn't like it, no one is that stupid probably.
Right.
Or weird, or like personally invested in how much you personally care about something.
Oh yeah, they are.
That's not my experience,
yeah.
Fortunately. But I mean, I would much rather be an outlier in the other direction of like bringing attention to shows that other people aren't talking about, like Preach, but other shows that are good as well.
Yeah.
Because you don't need to be the 9,000th person reviewing Mad Men. Like, I mean, we do cover Mad Men, or we did, but like. There's lots of places to read about those shows. I would rather shine a spotlight on stuff that's getting undercovered that's cool or weird or interesting.
Yeah.
And the thing that the internet reminds us is that there really are a lot of people who love even what we think of as the worst of TV shows. And the shows that get canceled that are awful, many of them have, if they're on CBS, they have 8 or 9 or 10 million viewers.
Yeah.
And some people genuinely love those shows. And so I'm always shocked when something gets canceled. And in my mind, it's like, okay, that's awful. I can't imagine someone is going to say, I am so pissed off that NBC canceled Jimmy Smith's In Outlaw. But when NBC canceled Jimmy Smith's Outlaw, for like 6 or 8 months afterwards, people slowly discovered that Outlaw was no longer airing on NBC. And they went on the internet and said, was Outlaw canceled? And so they popped up months later in comments going, I can't believe Outlaw was canceled. And all you can think was, wow, there actually were fans for that show. But there are honestly fans for everything, and they love Stalker, they love Mixology, they love Outlaw, they love so many of the things that we think are bordering on unacceptable to like, but millions of people love those shows.
Yeah. Let's ask some questions about this portion of what I just heard.
Is this about Preach?
It can be. I think you guys touched on this a little, but I think there's an interesting balance between what you're talking about, following the buzz and then creating the buzz. So how do you navigate that dichotomy and appease the general public, but still be that necessary front runner pioneer that you guys need to be?
I just sort of follow my gut in terms of what I'm going to write about, and really, because I'm only one person and have like one or two other people backing me up. So I just have to really be like, I really want to write about this. Because the thing about the internet is that anything you put on it is there forever. So like I will have people discovering my Fortitude stuff still now as it's like, as they're watching it on their DVR or whatever. So like that's for me, it's just, I don't worry too much about what's going to drive exciting buzz.
I mean, we can't, because there are so many sites that do things varying on what we do. And so if we're not passionate or engaged about it, someone else is, and someone else is going to do a much, much better job of covering the stuff that we're ambivalent about, but that they love or hate, whichever the case is. At a certain point, it has to be clear that, okay, you know, if Gotham isn't working for us, it is working for someone else, and so they can be passionate about that. We'll hopefully be passionate about enough other things that we still have value, but we'll just accept that we're not going to be valuable on that thing, that one 420th of the spectrum.
I would say that at the Hollywood Reporter, it's also different between what the site wants and your boss wants than what you want, right? I mean, so I definitely have been told, like, let's get out in front on this, or we think this is going to be huge and it's going to be good. And I'm like, yeah, if I've seen it, I sometimes agree. If not, I'm like, well, let's not get out in front of it if it's going to be terrible. Who cares, right? Why are we even reviewing it? And sometimes it comes to bite them in the ass, because they were all super gung-ho to have me do Daredevil, which I hated, and that, you know, still getting a lot of super negative feedback about that. But so I think it's bosses maybe want to be a create talk, and I don't think that's really our job.
I actually didn't have a question. I wanted to say that I worked on Jimmy Smith's Outlaw, so I was very upset when it went off the air.
Wow.
Nice work, Dan.
You have my condolences. And you should know that several people really, really loved it, and you were making a show for them, so.
You did good work.
Sorry, I wrote this down because it's a bit long-winded and I didn't want to forget it. But Tara, you said earlier that you assign others to cover shows, and I believe that's true of both Todd and Dan as well. And I was just wondering if you're more likely to assign people that you think will be more favorable when they cover them. Like for Dan, when you reviewed Hater, it's one of the, you know, I like reading your stuff. I watched Survivor Amazing Race, but that was just fun. But I'm just curious, you guys obviously pay attention to traffic on your sites, and do you find you get better traffic from positive reviews, negative reviews? Does that enter into who you assign at all?
Yeah, we definitely assign it to people that we think are going to either like it or like writing about it, and that's not always the same thing. And, you know, I personally assign myself Under the Dome. It's not my favorite show, but I do love writing about it because it's so dumb. But yeah, we try to match up people that are going to be excited to write about it. We don't want it to be a grind, and yeah, that's my answer.
Is that show really about like an egg now? Is that really what's going on there?
Yeah. It's all about the egg.
The other day I went back and read like my last few posts about the season, because I honestly could not remember what had happened. The show is insane. Does anyone here watch it? Anything could happen. Like, anything could happen. There are no stakes. It's so crazy.
I also love that you just, I'll watch. I love that.
It's bad, right? But it's crazily addictive, because it's like I have to know what cockamamie thing they're gonna come up with next. Like, now the dome is turning and that's making the weather different. Let's jump in this hole because maybe we'll end up in this other town. Like, there's so many questions about it. Anyway, it's coming back this month, so see you at previously.tv.
I don't do a lot of assigning now, but we do find that our greatest hits are hyperbolic in either direction. Like, if I can say The Americans is the best show on TV, people will click on that. But if I say something is one of the best shows on TV, nobody will click on that. So like, I have found increasingly it is a method of like managing hyperbole so that I'm being accurate, but also like being as hyperbolic as possible to get people to read my article. So.
But the line between passion and hyperbole is so blurry anyway. So I think my answer would be that when we get people to write stuff, we want them to be passionate, and it doesn't have to be necessarily positive or negative. I mean, we had our writer who did Outlander this season, and she loved it at the start of the season. She hadn't read the book. She knew absolutely nothing. She loved it. Diana Gabaldon was linking to her reviews, tons of traffic, marvelous. Around halfway through the season, she turned on it rather dramatically.
That's funny, because our writer had the same experience.
So dramatically, and suddenly it went from being the everyone in the Outlander community, you know, passing along her reviews and going, oh, this is a great example from an open-minded non-reader who loves this book, to this is the person who should read the books because then she would discover how awesome it is. But regardless, it's the journey, and to me, the journey is important, unless the journey is from passion to ambivalence, in which case, probably it's time for, you know, someone to check out.
Just one sidebar about Outlander, because that's an interesting example. We, on our, because we have bulletin boards as well as comments, but we have different areas for people who have read, like we'll have a thread about the episode for people who read the books and a thread for people who haven't, and they're very different. Really, really different. And the people who've read the books really look down on the non-book readers and like, they're not getting this or that. It's funny.
I think that you want to find people who, I don't think they have to like the show, but in my AV Club days, we had people write about The Following every season, and they just continually were giving it Fs. And like, people still love to read those reviews. They had a good time with that.
Like, it depends on the show. I mean, sometimes that's what people are getting out of it, because they're also watching it being completely confused by why this is even a show.
It's just like, you want somebody who's going to have fun and is going to have a passionate voice writing about it. You don't necessarily want somebody who really loves it.
So now that we are in a post-Mad Men era and summer TV is starting, is there a particular trend in what's happening on TV now that you think is interesting and that you want to see more of?
This is such a cliche answer, but I'm really interested in the increasing amount of shows that are not about the default white guy in his 40s who has to choose between being a good man and being a bad man. That's not to say that there isn't a way to do that show well. Like, Better Call Saul is a good show and is basically what I just described. But there's so little room to maneuver in that field anymore that something like Unreal pops even more for being about something other than that. Or, you know, Empire is so much fun because it's a lot of soapy tropes that have been done millions of times before, but it's set in a world that I haven't seen on TV. And so I think in general, diversity is a fun thing to be seeing popping up right now. And I hope it isn't as like bland as a trend. I hope that it gets a real foothold.
Yeah, when I wrote about Happy-ish, is anyone watching that show on Showtime?
Boom.
No. I mean, I it took me a second to remember when you asked that question, because I knew there was something I'd written recently where, like, the main part of my what we do as a new show fact sheet was sort of review-esque, but I wrote, I'm just so sick of men, and I couldn't remember what show it was about. It was about that one, but it really could be almost anything. Like, you know, your problems are not that interesting, especially on that show.
That's a good lead, by the way. I'm just so sick of men. Start with that.
Aren't we all? Guys, come on.
I know I am. I mean,
right.
And because of the amount of time that I also spend writing about the industry, I'm very interested in the increased number of shows that are sort of continuing to exist for random reasons. Like, everything used to be as simple as the Nielsens would come in the next morning, and that was the answer for whether something was a success or a failure. That was why something got renewed, et cetera. I'm enjoying looking at kind of the phenomenology of something like Hannibal, of something like Beauty and the Beast, which is apparently returning for its 17th season this week, and has already been renewed through 2053. And yet, I don't know anyone who watches that show, and that's because I kicked the people who watch that show out of my life because I'm a bad person. But no, I'm interested in sort of the different ways that the networks are doing their business. That are, it's all sort of part and parcel with what we're talking about up here, is the, you know, too much TV, but not just too much TV, but how is something a success, how is something a failure, and, you know, who judges and how they judge those things. So I think that's a fun thing to look at.
Over there. There's two over there. Go ahead. You can just blurt it out if you want.
I was just going to ask about how you feel about adaptations. You do the research. You talked about Outlander and Hannibal. I'm a Leftovers fan, and which I know a lot of critics have been.
No, I'm here.
No, I watched all of it.
We're a pro Leftovers panel, I believe.
I love it.
But kind of how do you watch the source material?
Todd and Todd and I would like to have a long conversation with everyone about the books for Wayward Pines, because we went out and read all three of them.
I did read. Well, the thing is, I saw the ads for Wayward Pines. I did. I saw the ads.
You're doing the panel, but
I saw the ads for Wayward Pines like a year ago and was like, I don't really want to watch this, but I want to know what happens at the end. And the ebooks were really short, so I read all the ebooks, and now I am a Wayward Pines expert. They were the books. I always tell people the books were so terrible, and I want more of them.
I mean, there's no way in hell that I'm reading the Under the Dome book, if that's what you're asking. But yeah, I don't have time to read. I watch 10 hours of TV a day.
Oh, totally. If the source is a book, I'm never gonna read it. That's not. And especially if it's like Game of Thrones, like, oh my God. Like,
this is my most embarrassing confession. The only way I read is if a book, and this is 100% true, is if I have a book beside me while I'm watching something that I've DVR'd that has commercials. Then I let the commercials run and I read in the commercials. You can read like 40 pages an hour that way. That's 100%.
You would never get through Song of Ice. You would never get through that. No, it's a George R. R. Martin book. You would never, you'd be still reading.
Well, I'm not reading those
70.
Either. Come on. Watch the show though.
I had read the Game of Thrones books when that show started, the ones that had been published up to that point. And so I thought, well, I'll write reviews for people who have read the books and we'll have somebody do for those who haven't. And it turned into this huge burden because I had to like constantly know what had happened in all the books, which meant I had to reread them all the time. And I just like, yeah, who has time to read?
Well, that's a perfect example though, because for the practical purposes of our criticism, that show has now changed. I mean, I didn't read the books, but that show, I know people who have, and they talk about it, and I follow people who are split up their threads between readers and non-readers. The show has changed so much that now readers are being surprised for the first time. And I think that, I don't know about you guys, but my general philosophy is that you judge it by how it appears in the format you're reviewing. So yeah. If it's not a good TV show, it's not a good TV show.
But I've just always been prone to reading the books before movies, before TV shows, so I read the first of the Outlander books. I haven't read any subsequent ones. I read all the, you know, George R. R. Martins, et cetera, all the Wayward Pines. But I always did that with movies as well. But I think I also used to read novelizations of movies, which is sort of an even stranger and more backwards way of doing that. To this day, my favorite book of all time is the novelization of Willow.
Wow. Okay.
I mean, I read Going Clear before I watched the documentary, and I think I mentioned that like 17 times in my post about that. But otherwise, I don't have time.
I mean, I do try and read a book every couple weeks, which is like an ambitious goal of mine that I rarely live up to. But like, if it doesn't work as a TV show on its own, like if you are saying, well, you really should have read the books, then the show is a failure. Like it just doesn't work.
All right, we'll transition, and we'll have a question at the end if you're still there. But we'll transition quickly into the we'll go through like a power round. This is where, when we put this out, Caitlin and Emily were like, yeah, this would be good. We'll throw it to you. You moderate, you just throw out questions and have these three people debate it. So I'll throw some topics out, and you guys can, you know, quick fire your responses. There we go. Amazon will be more influential and important than Netflix.
Not until it's on Apple TV, because I never remember to watch any Amazon originals, because it's not convenient for me.
No, and I think Transparent is better than, well, Orange is the New Black is probably better than Transparent, but Transparent is better than almost all Netflix shows.
Okay, this is not a fun thing if I say no, so yes, absolutely. Because they have a visible business model because of the things that they sell. And so I understand why Bosch is worth something to Amazon. I understand why a lot of things are worth things to Amazon. And I understand what their business model is. And so I don't need to see their ratings because I can actually look at what Amazon is producing and I can go, okay, this is how this fits with what the Amazon brand is and was before. And I can't always do that with Netflix. And so yes, I'm saying absolutely.
Sure. And yet the Netflix actually turns a profit, and Amazon, as Silicon Valley has taught us all, like hasn't turned a profit for 20 years. So
I didn't say I was right. I said I was being ornery.
That's good. I like that approach. Okay, next one. Is Game of Thrones overrated?
At this point, yes.
I would say at this point, yes as well, though the last episode was awesome.
I don't watch it, so I guess I have to say yes.
Then no.
You're supposed to say no. What's the better job to have, TV critic or movie critic?
I do both of them now, movie critic. But like I love being a TV critic. I love being a TV critic, but sometimes it's nice when something ends.
Yeah.
And you could just be like...
I mean, movie critic is an easier job for sure, because I have done both in my time. But yeah, TV, it doesn't end. Like the weeks that you're like, oh my God, there's an award show instead of The Good Wife. It's like you feel like you're going to have a week-long vacation. Even if it's a show that you like.
I remember the first movie I reviewed when I switched jobs was I reviewed Boyhood. And I got to the end of that movie and I was like, huh, that was like a closure? There was like an end? What was that?
On one hand, TV critic you can do in your boxers on your couch, which is very nice. On the other hand, movie critic, they will often give you free popcorn, which is also nice. So pros and cons to each.
So one getting off the couch and the other one getting fed. Yeah, that's interesting.
Neither one of these is a recipe to any particular degree of heart health, but whatever.
What network or channel has the worst online site to see shows?
Oh, like press sites?
Yeah, press sites or where you would watch a screener.
I know the popular answer is ABC. Everyone hates it, but NBC's is really bad too. The quality of their screeners is way worse in my experience.
Honestly, this is so ironic, but it's Netflix. I have so many problems with the Netflix player. Like it used to be ABC, but Netflix has them now beat by a mile. And you'd think that would be the easiest part, but no.
Yeah, I have to split the difference, because for actual screeners, definitely Netflix is the worst. It's astounding that a company that does, you know, streaming video is unable to successfully stream video for critics. In addition, our names are written across multiple times the screen, so you're basically watching your name. And if, for example, you're watching Daredevil and everything in Daredevil is pitch black and your name is in white, that's exactly the way those filmmakers
want. Yeah, you don't notice it as much on Grace and Frankie, I guess.
Exactly. You can put my name anywhere you want, and that's totally fine. So definitely for screening, it's Netflix. For other type things, NBC and ABC are both pretty abominable ways to spend time.
HBO has moved to the online screeners. That's actually a very good site for us now.
Yeah, their site is great.
But their site for you to go to is really terrible. Like to go to HBO, it takes like 8 minutes for it to load. I always say, does anybody who actually works at HBO, have you ever loaded your own site? Unbelievable.
You can be sure no one at Netflix has, because otherwise
yeah,
they wouldn't.
No, they haven't. All right, so is being a fanboy or a fangirl a negative comment? Or is it a slur? If somebody says, you're a fanboy, fangirl.
Oh, to you?
Negative or positive?
I don't think I've ever heard that, so I don't know. I guess if someone called, I can't even imagine what I would be fanning about that I would be insulted to be identified.
You are such a preach fangirl.
I mean,
I've never heard anyone other than
you
talking about that show, so.
I used to write the world's most glowing community reviews, and I would inevitably say one or two small minor points so I could say I was a TV critic. And there is an entire blog dedicated to how I am not enough of a community fan. I'm not going to tell you the address, but if you go look for it, you can find it. And like, they still are writing about me, so there you go.
And the things that I love, I love. What am I going to say? You know, it's not like I'm going, yes, I am a fanboy of dot, dot, dot. But if someone, you know, if in the comments, people have took over the season to calling me a Mad Men apologist. I mean, like, what does that even mean to be an apologist for that show?
Right.
But so my answer is, okay, sure, whatever. So, yeah, you know, if I like something, I like something. What am I going to say?
Who is the best host in late night?
Stephen Colbert.
He doesn't have a show yet.
But come on. But we know.
All right, so old
he was school. In Late Night.
Yeah, he was, but he's not now. Okay.
But he will be.
All right.
I guess I'm a Stephen Colbert fangirl.
No, none of them. I don't know. Maybe.
Ouch. None of
maybe
them.
Maybe John Oliver. Does he count? Like, he shouldn't count because he's only on once a week. Like,
still
he counts. He counts.
But he doesn't really host. I mean, hosting implies that people are joining you, and he's only joined by the gecko and by other various random dancing, you know, characters.
Well, host slash TV show late night.
I guess John Stewart by default, but he sort of seemed bored by that job for like 3 years now. Like it's a grim time for late night right now. I'm hoping Colbert does something great with Late Show.
Wow, that's really interesting. Okay, worse.
Why? What's your answer? I know you're moderating, but what would you have said?
I would say Kimmel.
At least it's not Fallon.
At least it wasn't Fallon. And I do like the work that Corden's doing. It's really interesting. Worst late night host.
Magic Johnson still.
I'm not a big Jimmy Fallon fan. I thought he was okay on late night, but I think his Tonight Show has been kind of, I don't know. It feels like everybody's just trying to make YouTube videos now, and that's fine, but is like not, I don't know. I don't like him.
I wouldn't say he's the worst, but Seth Meyers should stop interviewing presidential candidates like yesterday, because it's not great.
Interesting. Okay. In 10 years, most television will be watched on a phone. True or false?
On a phone or phone-like device, I think. I think for a lot of people, for a lot of like people under 30 or so, that's probably how they consume most of it anyway.
Is 10 years going to be enough for all of that cool Strange Days technology to happen? Because I want to put on a funny little hat and I want to have it all beamed into my head that way. I think 10 years is probably too soon for that. I think basically smaller and smaller things are becoming what it is. So if it's watches, if it's phones or tablet devices, definitely not on a TV, that's for sure.
That's so funny. I would say the opposite. I still think that people will continue to watch. I mean, maybe more, but I don't think most. I think TV is still something that people enjoy, like, settling down in front of. And if everyone's going to be watching them on their phones, why are our TVs getting so bigger and curved for whatever reason?
And I think really maybe the question more is, are people going to be watching more in sort of online television, perhaps on their TVs? And, like, in that case, I think definitely yes. We're probably shifting to that model.
Yeah. Can a genre show, for example, just as an example, Game of Thrones, can a genre show ever win the Emmy for Best Drama?
Sure.
Lost did.
X-Files won many Emmys. Game of Thrones has won lots of Emmys. It just hasn't won the series Emmy. Yes, I think that the complaint from people that genre shows don't get properly honored by these things, it's based on the fact that some genre shows have gotten screwed, you know, so... Should Buffy the Vampire Slayer have been nominated for more Emmys? Probably yes. But that doesn't mean that the genre itself has been persecuted.
And Buffy had a lot of other things going against it, like its network, which was never going to be recognized.
Yeah, much more it didn't get nominated for things because it was on the WB and UPN, and much less because it was quote-unquote genre.
Sure.
I like that. The Walking Dead should be nominated for a Best Drama, yes or no?
No.
I probably like The Walking Dead more than either of these two. If it happened, I would not be upset, but I don't think it's one of the six best dramas.
I mean, the Emmys have gotten so many things wrong. Like, it's hard to get that exercised about what they do or don't nominate, honestly. That seems like such a wishy-washy answer, but it's the truth. Like, I don't even watch the
Emmys. No, that's perfect, because it translates into this next topic.
Great.
Which, if any, award shows matter?
Oh, none. I mean, do they? I guess the Emmys probably brings, interest and helps build.
I think.
But at this point, like, does that even make a difference? Like, Mad Men has won, and that didn't make that a hit.
I remember when Arrested Development won, and I thought that was going to boost its ratings, and that worked out well. I think an Oscar still matters. I think if you win an Oscar, like, that's the first line of your obituary. But I think that's it of the competitive awards. Like, if you win a Nobel Peace Prize, great. Well, good for you.
Is that how we're judging matter? Is if it gets to be the first line of your obituary?
Well, or? I think that like they're inherently like stupid things anyway.
I wanted to know what matters means before I answer, because the answer is no, none of this matters.
Well, but, not in the existential case, Dan. We are all going to die.
The difference
between what
matters and what I care about are two totally different things.
Does any award show matter to what it's
in the realm of the actual industry?
So, like the example that Todd brought up of Arrested Development, that's the kind of thing that you're referring to? I don't think that even makes that big a difference anymore.
But I still think it matters. I still think it did get three seasons because of that. I don't think it mattered in terms of ratings, but it mattered in terms of what the perspective was of the industry towards it in a matters sense.
I think that if you win an Oscar, if you're an actor and you win an Oscar, your quote goes up. I don't know that the Emmys have a similar phenomenon.
Okay. Second to last question. The schedule doesn't matter anymore. Time slots don't matter. None of the schedule flow matters anymore. True or false?
False.
That's false.
Definitely matters. It matters less than it used to, but that doesn't mean it. That doesn't mean that it doesn't matter.
I think the success of ABC's last schedule sort of proves that schedules still do matter to some degree.
I mean, they obviously matter to someone because all of the important shows are on Sundays, right? Like, that's the biggest marker,
Sunday
I think.
And Thursday, yeah.
Yeah.
So just as an aside, not a debate forum. I mean, so all this talk about shifting platforms to Netflix and Amazon's not going to impact the schedule. I mean, a lot of people will say, in the future, there will be no schedule. You just watch it when you want to, on demand.
I just think we're a longer way away from a lot of this than a lot of people think we are. You know, you look at CBS's ratings, and CBS's ratings prove that an awful lot of people like to watch TV in very traditional ways, and like to watch fairly traditional TV in very traditional ways, and that there are between 15 and 20 million people who want to watch NCIS, and then because an NCIS spinoff is on immediately afterwards, that's literally audience flow. They will watch the next thing. That is as traditional and 1950s, 60s television values as you could imagine. And you look at CBS, and that's proof that it works for some people.
And I would also say that paradoxically, the rise of social media has made TV in some ways even more of a communal experience. There's still some shows that you want to watch when you know everyone else is watching them, not just because you don't want to get spoiled, but because you want to share that experience with other fans.
Yeah, I think that's something we didn't actually touch on, which would have been interesting, and that is how some showrunners don't like to have all 13 episodes drop because we're not all watching it at the same time or not commenting it at the same time. All right, then going into what will soon be Emmy nominations, best drama on television right now?
The Americans.
I'm a madman apologist.
I mean, this is a cheat answer, but I certainly found that last season of Justified really, really satisfying. So that would be my pick, even though it's not on anymore. It's still eligible this year, so I would say that counts.
If those were the three of the drama nominees, I would be very happy.
Agreed.
They won.
Best comedy on television.
Veep.
Go ahead.
John Oliver at the moment.
I mean, my favorite comedy is Transparent, but that doesn't count. I'm really enjoying, this is not the best, but I'm really enjoying Silicon Valley right this season. I think
it's pretty good. Funny.
Also, Orange is the New Black is a comedy.
Well, I'm sure HBO would happy about it. Veep, John Oliver, Silicon Valley, they're going to be pretty happy about that.
I said it last week that I was watching Game of Thrones, and it was a great episode last week, and I was thinking, wow, Game of Thrones is currently my fourth favorite show on Sunday night on its own network.
Yeah, I saw that.
I was thinking that spoke pretty well for how HBO is doing at the moment.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we have a few minutes left. We want to throw it open to anybody who has final questions about anything. It doesn't have to be a debate format. Thanks for enduring our little mini debate. And then we'll wrap it up. If you have questions, you raise your hand, and then she'll bring the microphone around.
And this is for Tara. I wondered, since you do kind of review-esque things for each of the shows, how the ideas for each of the shows kind of specific way of being talked about on your show is developed.
Oh, that's a great question. We have a whole bunch of different kind of feature formats, ways of looking at shows, and so I love to watch an episode and just write something that's the content's suggested. So for example, we're also watching all of Aquarius, although we're splitting up who's writing about what. So my post about the third episode was all about how dumb it was that they used the word ball instead of the F word. Like, I know it's a network show, but like using ball as a noun or a verb meaning fornicate. So it was just like a little five paragraph rant about how silly that was, and wouldn't it be better if they just ducked out the audio? So like, I think that the more specific and personal and weird that we can get about shows, the more our site, previously.tv, is unlike other sites. What we always try to do is write something that you're not going to read somewhere else. And as far as I know, no one else wrote about that.
Oh, I wish I had.
So you guys talked a lot about the glut of quality television, but
Like, what if a show like Freaks and Geeks was being produced today? What network would be on? How would it be produced? Would it last more than one season? How would that go down?
It would be on NBC, and it would get canceled after 15 episodes.
But would NBC make Freaks and Geeks now? I don't think
they
it would.
Wouldn't.
NBC would not make that show today.
It
probably
would be on ABC Family. It would be a lot more brightly lit. Everybody would be a lot more attractive, and it would probably run 4 or 5 seasons, and like Emily Nussbaum would write something in season 4 about how it was really great television nobody cared about, and like I wouldn't watch.
Well, you say that, but whenever ABC Family makes a show that actually crosses over to kind of critical respect, and keep in mind Freaks and Geeks did air on ABC Family, those are the shows at which we get miserable because Bunheads was canceled after one season, or you know, or being pissed off that Chloe King didn't even get a second half of a first season. So.
Well, I mean, The Fosters is a good show.
The Fosters show. Is a good show. Switched at Birth is a good show. Greek was a good show that had a good long run on
Bunheads. Bunheads. Just briefly, to go on that topic, I actually was covering television exactly when that happened and had one of those moments where that when Garth Ancier took over NBC, he was going to be at a party that night. I saw him walking in the Ritz-Carlton where we have the TCA, ran over to him and then everybody's piling in. I was able to get to him very first without any microphone or anything. I said, tell me about Freaks and Geeks. Are you going to cancel that? And he said, this is a direct quote, I prefer good looking people on television. Then he canceled it. Good.
So how about the baseball site? Are there other critics that you enjoy reading or other sites that you go to for when you want different insight or opinion or feedback?
I read Dan Fienberg and Tara Ariano. And Tim Goodman. No.
These two fine people right here.
I love Matt Soler's sites. Like, he is one of the people who's really not afraid to be a crazy outlier, and I think that's valuable. I read Emily Nussbaum, of course. I read a lot of TV criticism, but I read a lot of the AV Club alumnuses I worked with. That was not the proper plural of that. I apologize.
Emily Nussbaum at New Yorker tends to be very, very valuable to me because A, she's a great writer and she's a great thinker, but also she doesn't, for the most part, do sort of pre-launch reviews. And so if I stay, I do try to stay away from reading what people say if I'm trying to formulate my own opinion. So I'm not reading that many reviews before I write one of my own, but I like that when she writes about something, it tends to be a few weeks after because she's had the chance to give it consideration, she's had the chance to sort of put it in context, and I find that to be very valuable.
Yeah, everybody I follow on Twitter almost everybody I follow is a TV critic of some sort, so I read all their stuff. Never before, you never want to be biased about it, and I want to be poisoned the water somehow. But I read everybody after, and I guess that's part of the thing. And I also read people that when I came up, they were sort of mentors to me, which is Matt Rausch, a TV Guide magazine, and Robert Bianco at USA Today. They're great, and both of them are sort of masters at writing very short because of their publications, and it's impossible for me to write anything that's short. So that's always good. Matt Zollersites, I think Alan Sepinwall, somebody who came up the same year I did and know him well enough and read his stuff, and I'm amazed by how much, and horrified and appalled at how much stuff he turns out. And I'm always telling him he's a terrible influence for everybody else because if my boss sees what he's doing, I'm going to be in real trouble.
Funny, I always tell him he doesn't work nearly enough and she should be churning out much more content, so.
In addition to all the fine people already mentioned, I should say Margaret Lyons of Vulture and Pilot Virouette of FlavorWire and Sonia Soraya and Willa Paskin and Maureen Ryan, who's on a leave of absence at the moment of Huffington Post.
But. I want to say something about Todd, too, because I came up through newspapers, and at the TCA, there was this totally inside baseball, which is what you said, but there was a whole thing about not taking people from online, which, of course, I was totally against that and led that charge. We had to take them. That is definitely the future, you old geezers. But of the internet generation of people who came up as critics on the internet, I think Todd's amazing. So,
thank you.